Hello everybody and welcome to an Attack on Titan video. As you may already know, Season 4, the final season of Attack on Titan, is just around the corner. It will be premiering on December 7th. But before I get into it, I'll just mention my experience with the show very briefly. So I watched the first season and the second season of Attack on Titan as they were coming out. I thought those seasons were pretty good overall. And then I started Season 3, started watching it in the anime, and I almost ended up dropping the show. And upon reflecting on it, I realized that it had very little to do with the content, with the material itself, but it mainly had to do with the way in which the content was being presented. What I mean is this: there is so much information in Season 3. The season has so many info dumps, and they come at you so fast. And by the way, I'm not just talking about historical information. I'm talking about information about political dynamics that the show throws at you as well, hoping that you'll just keep track of it, right? So it gets to be too much in Season 3, especially when you compare it to the previous two seasons, where the information was delivered more gradually and organically to the viewer. You had more time to digest the info back then. And so my personal recommendation for anybody who is not caught up is to watch Season 1, Season 2 of the anime in their entirety, and then go to the manga. Start from Chapter 51 after you finish Season 2 of the anime, and then keep reading the manga until you hit the Battle of Shiganshina District, because the Battle of Shiganshina looks amazing in the anime. It's the best thing that Season 3 pulls off by far. And then after that, you get to decide whether to stick with the anime and wait for Season 4, or just binge read the manga chapters that are left. Because either way, this story is ending soon.
Now, to be fair with Season 3, I also think it's important to mention that Season 3 has a much more difficult job than the previous two seasons had. Because in Season 3, the world of Attack on Titan expands. Season 3 is a transition, because that's where the story goes from humanity versus the Titans to humanity versus itself. And so it does kind of make sense that that transition, that shift in the narrative, would require a lot more information than I was used to getting. Again, the problem really isn't the amount of information, it's more of the way that the information is presented. It's usually presented in, like, you know, several different sections or snippets sprinkled throughout Season 3. And so what I'm gonna try and do with this video is I'm gonna stick to the history of the Titans. I'm gonna take the info pertaining to their history, and I'm gonna try and come up with some type of coherent, semi-linear thing that gets us ready for Season 4. So hopefully it works. If it doesn't, screw it, I tried my best. I spent a lot of time thinking about what kind of spoilers I wanted to drop in this video, and so I came to the conclusion that since I'm gonna be talking about history, I'm only going to be spoiling things that have to do with the past, with the history of the Nine Titans. So I'm not really going to talk about, like, future developments, but I am going to mention some things that have happened in the past that may have not been revealed to you yet if you don't read the manga. So I don't think the spoilers are going to be too big of a deal, but that being said, if you want to go into Season 4 clean, without knowing anything, then yeah, this video contains spoilers. So here we go.
This whole thing started a long time ago with two main groups, one being the tribe of Eldia and the other being the nation of Marley. Now, the tribe of Eldia was led by the family of Fritz, the Fritz family. And within the tribe of Eldia, there was a girl named Ymir.
Yamiru!
Anyway, this girl Ymir became the reason for why Titans exist in the first place. Because due to some strange encounter with an unknown source, she gained the power of the Titans. So she turned into the founding Titan, which is the first Titan ever. Now, the king of Eldia found out about Ymir's power and used her as a weapon against the nation of Marley. And this is why, depending on who you ask, according to history, Ymir is either considered the main source of good of the story or the main source of evil in the story. Like, the Eldians believe that Ymir was a divine emissary, a miracle of God sent to foster goodwill on Earth. Meanwhile, the Marleyans believe that Ymir actually made a deal with the devil to obtain her Titan powers and be able to destroy the world. When in fact, the truth is that reality is a lot grayer than that, and both sides are wrong about Ymir. So it's very cool that from the very beginning, this story has actually always been about how we as people perceive good and evil, and how that depends entirely on two things. Number one, it depends on what other people teach us, and number two, it depends on our personal experiences. Anyway, at one point, as the conflict of Eldia versus Marley continues, the king of Eldia has three children with Ymir. Three daughters, specifically. And then a bit later, a soldier from Marley attempts to kill the king, but Ymir gets in the way, and she dies instead of the king. And so Ymir, who is the founding titan, ends up dying 13 years after she obtained the power of the titans. Now, because the king of Eldia was such a swell guy, he tells his daughters to eat Ymir's body, and that way Ymir's power gets passed down to them. And eventually, the three girls pass down their power to their grandchildren, and that's where we have the creation of the nine intelligent titans. The founding titan, also called the coordinate, the attack titan, the armored titan, the colossal titan, the female titan, the beast titan, the Cartman titan, the jaw titan, and the warhammer titan. And so it was that by using the power of all nine, the Eldian people, descendants of Ymir, end up conquering and wiping out a ton of people that supposedly, if you add up all of the casualties, you would end up with a total that would equal three times the entire world population.
Also during that time period, what would happen is that since each of the royal families had one titan each, the nine families would constantly try and fight each other to be able to gain the power of a new titan. However, no matter how bad the conflict got between the nine families, the king of Eldia was always there to keep the peace. He was always there to break them apart and maintain balance. And he could do that because he had the power of the coordinate, of the founding titan. Founding titan is above all of the other titans, so whenever the other nine families would fight, the king would show up and he would bring peace and balance. He was kind of like the Avatar. Except things obviously didn't stay that way. Obviously.
Eventually, after centuries of bloodshed and massacre, the founding titan's power makes its way to Karl Fritz, who's the 145th king of Eldia, or as I like to call him, King Guilty Conscience. Anyway, after finding out about the genocide committed by the Eldian Empire all over the world, King Fritz is all like, "Oh no, we've killed billions of people throughout the course of history, we can't keep doing this. What should we do? I can't allow the Eldian Empire to go on like this, it's too much. Eldia must fall." So, in order to make the empire fall, the king reaches out to the Tiber family, which is the family of Eldians that has the power of the Warhammer Titan. Basically, the king's plan is to leave the main continent behind and take his people over to a new island called Paradis. And in order to make sure that the empire falls, the Tiber family will be in charge of instigating a civil war in the main continent. So the point is to have the empire destroy itself from the inside out, which, if you read history, that's usually how most empires fall. By using the power of the founding titan, King Fritz then orders a crap ton of colossal titans to come together to create three walls that are named after Ymir's daughters, Maria, Rose, and Cinna. The king also uses the founding titan's power to wipe the memory of the people living inside the walls, so that they don't remember anything from the outside world. All the knowledge the people are left with is that they've been living inside the walls to protect themselves from the titans that are trying to eat them.
Now, before locking himself and his people inside of the walls, King Fritz also makes a wish. He makes a vow to renounce war. In other words, due to his guilty conscience, the king makes a rule for himself and for his entire line of descendants, which is that he will not, and therefore his descendants will not be able to use the power of the founding titan to fight. So if titans want to attack Paradis, or they want to destroy people inside the walls, the king has to let that happen because of this vow to renounce war. So the king stays locked up in Paradis with a bunch of his people. However, not every Eldian was okay with going to Paradis, so a lot of Eldians decided to stay back home in the mainland. And remember how I said that the king was kind of like the Avatar and was always there to maintain balance and peace amongst the nine families? Well, with the king gone, there was nobody there to keep the peace, and so the royal families that were left behind in the old continent went into civil war. Now, because of the conflict between the nine families, the people of Marley, who lived in that continent, decided to take advantage of the civil war and overthrow the royal families. And remember how I said that King Fritz had previously reached out to one of the families, the Tiber family, right? So when this conflict erupted, the Tiber family was ready. They were Warhammer ready. And they were like, hey, Marleyans, you need a hand? We'll help you out with our Warhammer Titan.
Eventually, the Marleyans end up taking control of 7 out of the 8 Titans that are still available on the mainland. And they make sure that the 7 powers are inherited only to Eldians who are willing to fight for the nation of Marley.
Like, the only 2 powers that the Marleyans couldn't get for themselves was the power of the Founding Titan that was already in Paradis, and the power of the Attack Titan. Now, because the Tiber family was the first ally to the Marleyans during the war, the Tiber family gets special treatment after the Marleyans win the war. The Tiber family is the only royal family that remains royal in the Old Continent. All the other Eldians are not so lucky. This is where the World War II references start, because the Eldians that are not part of the Tiber family are thrown into internment camps, internment zones. They have to wear a band across their arm to identify themselves. They are constantly told by others that they are the descendants of the devil and that they should feel guilty and want to atone for the mistakes committed in the past by their ancestors. I mean, literally the reason for why the Marleyans don't straight up exterminate the Eldians altogether is because the Eldians are the only humans capable of transforming into Titans. And so the Marleyans can use the Eldians as Titans, as instruments of warfare.
One of the Eldians living in the internment camp is a man called Grisha Jaeger, who, after suffering the loss of his sister by the hands of a Marleyan officer, he decides to join a secret group of Eldians in Marley called the Eldian Restorationists, which is basically a secret group of Eldians that are planning Marley's downfall. There, Grisha meets Dinah, or Dina Fritz, who is the descendant of the Eldian royal family, and the 2 of them get married and have a son, and they call him Zeke.
Now, unfortunately, because of his trauma of losing his sister the way that he did, Grisha Jaeger wasn't really a good father to Zeke. Essentially, the only thing that Grisha did as a father for Zeke was to indoctrinate him into hating Marley and wanting to restore Eldia. But Zeke was just a kid. Like, he just wanted a dad to play with him, to play ball with him. And so eventually Zeke snitches on his parents and he tells the Marleyan government, they're conspiring against you. They support Eldia. They're Eldian restorationists. And so that kind of leaves Zeke with a good status, a good position in Marley. And he eventually is chosen to inherit the power of the Beast Titan. Meanwhile, his parents are taken over to Paradis to be punished.
Before being injected with the same serum that turned his wife into a Titan, Grisha is saved by a man called the Owl, who was actually an Eldian spy all along. He was just pretending to be a Marleyan officer. And so this guy reveals to Grisha that he actually has the power of the Attack Titan, which again is the only one out of the 8 Titan powers within Marley that the Marleyans were not able to get. The Owl then gives Grisha the mission of heading inside of the walls and infiltrating them in order for him to find the Founding Titan and steal its power. The Owl then sacrifices himself to Grisha, allowing Grisha to obtain the power of the Attack Titan. Once inside the walls, Grisha gets himself a new smoking hot wife and a new baby boy named Aaron, but unfortunately his ex-wife gets kind of jelly, so she bites down on Grisha's new wife, making her explode like a tomato. Now, the main reason this connection is important is because it technically makes Aaron and Zeke half-brothers, because they have the same dad. Now, similar to Zeke, who sold out his parents to gain favor with the Marleyans, most Eldians living in Marley want to please the Marleyans so that they can have a better life. And one of the best ways to please the Marleyans, if you're an Eldian, is to join the army. So if you're an Eldian willing to fight for Marley, you can enlist, and if you're one of the best Eldians in the army, you have a chance of inheriting one of the 6 powers of the Titans. Remember, it's only 6 because the Warhammer Titan gets special treatment, so it's not included in those 6. A girl named Piek joins the military because her father had gotten sick inside the internment camp. And so in order to get him the proper medical treatment, the proper medical care outside of the ghetto, Piek joins the military, where she stands out because of her intelligence, because she's really smart, and so she is chosen to inherit the power of the cart titan. Berthold Hoover was chosen because of his aim. He was one of the best shots in his group, and so he was chosen to inherit the power of the colossal titan. And he mastered the power very quickly. Actually, he's said to be like the fastest one to master it. And in season 3, Berthold gets eaten by Armin, and so the power of the colossal titan now belongs to Armin. Annie Leon Hart was born out of an affair that her Marlian mother had with an Eldian man. So she was sent into the internment zone as a baby. Once there, the man who took her in forced her into some really harsh and cruel physical training, and so she became a ruthless fighter. And so after Annie joins the military, she gets praised for her hand-to-hand combat ability, and so she is chosen to inherit the power of the female titan. Reiner didn't really stand out for anything other than his loyalty to Marley, but he joined the military anyway because he wanted to be able to reunite with his father. Reiner's father was a Marlian, and his mother was an Eldian, and since unions between Marlians and Eldians are forbidden, Reiner thought that if he could just prove to the military that he was a worthy enough candidate, he would be able to become an honorary Marlian, and this would allow him and his mother to reunite with his father. So Reiner ends up doing all of that work, but by the end, his father rejects him anyway. That's why being a people pleaser sucks, because no matter how hard you try, if another person doesn't want to accept you, they won't. All we can do is accept ourselves. The Jaw Titan, I think, is actually the Titan that we get to see inherited the most within the story. First, it goes to Marcel, who stands out in the military because of his endurance, and so he is sent to Paradis on an infiltration mission along with Reiner, Annie, and Berthold. However, during their expedition to the Wall, the four of them run into Ymir, who was turned into a Titan as punishment for belonging to an Eldian cult. Ymir turns back into a human by eating Marcel and inheriting the Jaw Titan power for herself, but later on she decides to actually give the power back, and so she allows herself to be eaten by Marcel's brother, Porco. Now, the day that Reiner and Berthold break through Wall Maria to let the Titans in, Grisha finds the royal family inside of a secret chapel hideout, and once there, he pleads with Frieda Fritz, / Frieda Rees, to use the power of the founding Titan that she inherited from her predecessors to control the Titans and stop them from killing innocent people. Unfortunately, because of King Fritz's vow to renounce war, Frieda can't use her power to stop the attack, and so her and Grisha start fighting, and Grisha defeats Frieda and eats her. So now Grisha has two powers, the power of the attack Titan that he inherited from the Owl, and the power of the founding Titan that he stole from the royal family. Later on, Grisha takes Eren into the woods and turns Eren into a Titan, allowing himself to be devoured, so Grisha lets himself be eaten by his own son, thus allowing Eren to inherit both the attack Titan power and the Founding Titan power. Now, since the Founding Titan power was only meant to be inherited within the royal bloodline, or within the people that belong to the royal family, and since Eren is not of royal blood, Eren cannot use the power of the Founding Titan to its full potential unless he touches somebody who is of royal blood.
It's why he has these special memories when he touches Historia, because Historia does belong to the royal bloodline. So it kind of gets me to think, like, what would happen if Eren and Historia were to have a kid? Now, the cool thing about Eren not being of royal blood is that whenever he touches somebody who is of royal blood, Eren is not bound by King Fritz's vow of renouncing war. So the rule of not using the Titans to fight does not apply to Eren, because he's not part of the royal family. That's why after Eren punches or touches Dina Fritz, he is able to command the Titans to attack her, because Dina Fritz was of royal blood. Like I said in the beginning of the video, this story, I feel, has evolved a lot in how complex it's gotten. Like, initially it was just about this kid wanting to get revenge, wanting to fight to protect humanity. But then you keep reading the story and it's like, wow, this is way more ambiguous than I thought it would be. It's not black and white, it's gray. And I remember thinking there was this one moment where I thought, wait a minute, like, why do I empathize with Eren so much? Is it just because, like, he's the main character and because I've spent a lot of time with him? It did kind of get me to think, like, I wonder what would this look like if the story was being told by somebody outside of the walls? Like, let's say, an Eldian that was living inside of the internment zone. Like, what if Reiner were the main character of the story? Like, how would that change things? Because at the end of the day, the truth that this story is trying to present is that everybody suffers, whether you're inside or outside of the walls. Even the people that inherit the power of the Nine Titans, they're still cursed, you know? Because after they gain that power, they only have 13 years to live. And if you're an Eldian living in Marley, you still have to live in that internment zone, in that internment camp. Not only that, but something else that gets brought up is that humanity is advancing technologically to the point where sooner or later, humanity won't need the Titans to use them as weapons because they will have weapons that surpass the Titans. And so even if you're one of the Nine Titans and you have a special power, you won't be needed anymore. And so once you're not needed, you go right back to being discriminated against. And so I really do think that that's what the story is about. The tragedy highlighted by the story of Attack on Titan is about the lack of freedom that people feel due to external circumstances that came about due to no fault of their own. Something we can all relate to. And I also think that's why Eren is like the foil to that, because Eren is supposed to stand up for freedom, right? Freedom fighter. At least that's how it was in the beginning. So yeah, just wanted to make a video talking about all these themes in this story. Thank you for watching. If you appreciated the video, leave me a thumbs up. That helps out the channel, helps out the video. Sasageyo, sasageyo. Subscribe if you haven't done so already. Thank you so much for watching. Take care. Catch you later. Bye.